at the Phillies Fire Company, as you talk about volunteerism, and you have the most volunteers, I think. Is that true? Is he still here?
Carly?
I don't know that. If I may.
Please.
Just there. On record, the Phillies do have the most amount of volunteers on record. And again, they are very integral. But again, as you saw, as I gave the report earlier, when we have the big fire, that's when they come out. I do need the volunteers on the small calls. And between the four companies, the continued support and commitment from them is about the same. However, the Phillies, again, to answer your question, do have the most on paper.
Thank you. I also was at an event for first responders where they had a lot of their volunteers there, and there were quite a few young people. So that wasn't the point that I was driving at, that they had recruited some young people to be involved in their volunteerism, which is excellent for a community such as Pottstown per se, with a school district with, you know, the free and reduced lunch criteria. And volunteerism really attaches itself in Maslow's hierarchy of needs right at the top. So anywhere you have volunteers, people really understand, and they're not struggling at the bottom of that pyramid with a sense of belonging. They've gone past that. So anytime that you do see volunteerism, you know that you have strong people.
And to answer that with the young firefighters that we are recruiting, we do have an agreement with the school district and a cooperation agreement with the school district to attempt to recruit the junior firefighters. The Phillies have an Explorer program as well as Empire, and the North End has a junior program. And the difference between an Explorer is 14 and 15 years old, where a junior firefighter is 16 and 17.
And what is the limit for a firefighter? I mean, I heard the comment that many are getting older. What does getting older mean in terms of signing up to be a firefighter?
Well, to actually fight fire inside a building, you have to be a minimum of 18 years old. And that it deals with the child labor laws. Plus, we also try to do it safely. You got to remember, though, everybody's running out of a burning building. We're the ones running in. So it kind of does make us a little crazy, I think. But it's a very dangerous and a very physical job. The equipment that we wear alone can wear anywhere from 50 to 60 pounds. So as we start to age, our bodies taking a toll. I can tell you that in my 32 years of fighting fire, I've broken my back, I've broken my knees, I've broken my ankles probably about 7 times. So it's a very physical, demanding job that does take its wear and tear on the body. And as they do start to age, they're finding that they want to come out less and less because it is painful. So, but we are always looking for the new and the younger firefighters, and we will train them and outfit them.
So what is the maximum age, and is there any criteria, such as with police, they have to go through physical agility as part of their hiring process? And in a career company situation, is that a requirement versus volunteer?
Being that it's volunteer, to be blunt, are you 18? Do you have a pulse and can you walk upright? I mean, quite honestly, we're taking any help that we're getting. There's no age limit. We do have some firefighters that are in their 70s. They may not be running into the building on fire, but they do help in other ways.
Okay, thank you. That was really what I was trying to find. If there is a limit, and there is not.
There is
under
not.
Under the volunteer situation.
And we're always looking for help. I'll train you personally.
You?
Don't tempt me. Because I'll show up. Well, I'd just like to make this, this is probably the last time as mayor that I'll be in a broadcast for PCTV. So I would just like to thank all of the voters who've come out, not only over these two terms, but the voters that have stood by me through the first school board race in 1997, where I had to pull out of the public forum for an emergency C-section, to come back to become a part of a very strong team to, you know, sweep the school board race on both sides. That was very exciting. After 2 years of operating under the notion that how unpolitical the school board was, with my feet to the fire, learned exactly how political the school board was. And after 2 years, felt an onus and an unction and a desire to come to the municipal side of government to understand the inner workings from this side. That required a transition for me from one side of the political aisle as a Democrat to the side of the Republican. Was that a decision on the philosophy of one side or another? It absolutely was not. But irregardless of the parameters that were the driver behind that decision, I can say today that I understand more about the political process from partisanism, as well as how it should be better separated from governance. So I'd just like to say, I think I could write a book on that just by my personal experiences in Pottstown. It was very overwhelming to be elected by people that I knew were long-term Democrats who were very afraid but confident because they knew me from the grassroots and they knew me from community advocacy, not so much as organizing people but resourcing people so that they could be empowered to pursue their own decisions with knowledge and to make their own choices from a menu of options and not just by, per se, having a big giant group for one person's problem. So the more people that are actually empowered and understand how to pursue their issues really raises the base. And we're only as strong as our weakest link. And I believe also one thing that I've always stressed is that the common stock and the wealth of a community is the people. And I never have lost sight of that, and I never will lose sight of that. I would like to thank the colleagues and the presidents and managers that I've worked with over the years. I wouldn't say it was stressful. Of course, they can't say it's stressful either because they're getting a lot more money than I am to do their job. So I think they're quite suited and equipped for the challenges that they face. I'd like to just bring up 3 points that cover both terms. And one of those, I don't have it written down here. One of those is the mayor's initiative on neighborhoods, which was inside of the first term, which was expanded into the CARES Day. And expanded into the CARES Day with the Hill School, the community college, and the school district all coming together for a select and intentional day of service to the community. And back to the original thrust of the mayor's initiative on neighborhoods was to encourage residents to come out and be a part of that same intentionality on their own. And that still is in position, and that still is needed, because it's really about the empowerment of every person who's living in Pottstown, you know, from house to house, from corner to corner, whether it's a business or a home or an apartment, everybody has a part to play. I'd like to talk about the prayer initiative that was instituted during the first term of having an invocation. And during this term, we alternated with invocation and moment of silence. But I was just reviewing yesterday the Senate. The United States Senate opens in prayer with every session. Those prayers are not restricted. Our prayers had been restricted. There were people that prayed in Jesus' name in the state Senate in Washington, D.C. And, you know, this prayer effort did not only just include people that would be present in this room, but others that commit to keep the issues of the borough lifted in prayer, which is a universal spiritual activity that no one owns. And I think that we should always be thankful for those who take a position in prayer for the betterment of the common good. And I think I mentioned that in my prayer invocation today. The second thing I'd like to highlight is the number of weddings. Over two terms, close to 100 weddings. And that's important. And another thing I'd just like to mention in context of weddings is the stabilization of a nation. The stabilization of a nation boils down to the stabilization of families. So the more stable families we have, the more stable our nation is. So the stabilization of families, and just to mention, that was one of the most fun parts of the job, was conducting those wedding ceremonies. But as I continue, the stabilization of families will be a priority as I would continue in the grassroots and also learning more about the urban areas in the 6th Congressional District. And that's very important because many of those families in that district are in challenging school districts that are underfunded. And that is an issue at hand all across America, but especially in areas where we know that there are distinct deficits that are leading to substandard existences in some areas, such as Reading, Pennsylvania, with possibly by now over $100 million deficit. Teachers are purchasing school supplies to conduct their education, the educational process, and these expenses are not tax deductible. So I want to go and move on to an intersecting government issue in this transition for myself. As far as leaving the office of mayor as one government representation, I will still continue in the government representation through spiritual angles. And I invite you on December 31st to attend a special service where I've been given a bench that's going to have a lot of influence in the community in the coming years, having met a carpenter who has produced a bench for me that says live, love, and laugh. Well, what does that have to do with government? It has to do with the government of understanding that where there's some place for you to kneel, where there's some place for you to sit, where there's a safe place for you to lay down your head, there is a place for you to remember others that do not have this privilege. There are others that do not share in many of the privileges that we take for granted in America. So if you'd like more information on that location for December 31st, please contact me, and I would be glad to see you. It'll be 10 a.m. on that day. That's the end of my report, and thank you all so very much.
Thank you.